So let's talk about loss. Losing anything is hard, and losing control over a skill that you once had mastered is particularly rough. And of all our cognitive skills, maybe the one that's most true of is language, something that every typically developing human will pick up almost effortlessly. But we can lose anything that we have, and as linguists, it's our responsibility to find out what we can about the problem and try to help. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
So our brains are wired for language. We've got multiple regions set up specifically to do just that. Those parts skillfully and rapidly prepare our language, matching up words and sounds and putting them into the right structures so we can understand what people are saying to us and craft what we want to say back. We talked about the two main sections that deal with language, Broca's area and Wernicke's area, back in Topic 9. But like any other part of the brain, Broca's and Wernicke's areas are subject to damage and difficulties. Maybe it's an accident, or a stroke, or a brain tumor. Whatever it is, something happens, and it keeps these areas from functioning the way they're supposed to. That makes people lose some, or even all, of their ability to use language. This loss of linguistic ability is known as aphasia, and it can strike any component of our language faculty. While it's definitely very sad when people are stricken with aphasia, the patterns of behavior that these people show, alongside whatever damage is found in their brains, has told us a lot about how language works. It's the same as with other biological systems we have. Seeing what happens when things go wrong can give us a lot of insight into what's happening when everything is going right. Even the knowledge that language is located in Broca's and Wernicke's area originally comes from studies of patients with aphasia. Paul Broca and Carl Wernicke both identified their areas back in the 1800s by studying the brains of patients who showed specific, distinct patterns of language difficulties. Without the insights from their studies, we'd have had to wait decades until we had neuroimaging techniques to find out just where in the brain language resides. But before we dive into what we know about aphasia, let's take a step back and talk about some of the difficulties people have encountered studying these problems. The first comes from talking about the brain itself. You probably have a good image of what the brain looks like, right? You've seen pictures of its shape, its lobes and ridges, and you think, awesome. That's what I've got just right inside here. And well, that's not that far off from the truth, it's just that nobody's got that brain. Actually, no one's got the same brain as anybody else. The brain that we plot things on when we say that something is happening in a particular region, that's an average brain. And I don't mean by that like a run-of-the-mill normal specimen. I mean, it's a brain whose shape has been determined by carefully averaging the positions of various structures from a large number of scans of different people's heads. There's a lot of variation going on up here. All the different regions and structures may be roughly in the same areas, but we're just not carbon copies of each other. And it's not just those differences that matter. A lot can happen when things go wrong, too. If you have a stroke or a tumor, or you're in an accident and you damage your head, your brain isn't like a submarine. There aren't little dividing walls that keep the damage from spreading from one area into the next. What gets harmed could be a small part of a given area or a large swath of brain tissue. Just like no brain is the same as any other one, no brain injury is the same as any other one. And that means that we always have to be careful when we're looking at people's behavior after they've been injured, and compare the physical and linguistic problems that we find to see exactly what's going on. So these are a couple of considerations to keep in mind when you're looking into brain damage. Even with those limitations, though, we've been able to find out a lot about the brain over the years. And like I said earlier, studying people with different kinds of aphasia and matching up their behavior to the damage that happened in their brains can tell us a lot about how the mind works and how we process language. For today, we're going to talk about Broca's aphasia, the syndrome that occurs when Broca's area is damaged. There's a couple of really salient patterns that we can find in the speech of people with this condition. So if you meet someone who has Broca's aphasia, the first thing that'll probably be noticeable is their speech pattern. When Broca's aphasia patients try to talk, they have all kinds of problems. They stutter, they stop talking, they visibly struggle. Some of the time, they get so restricted in their speech that there's only one word that they can manage to get out. That was the case with the first patient Dr. Broca studied, a man generally known as Tan, because that was the only word he could say. Now, Tan may have been an extreme case, but pronouncing words the way that they want is very hard on Broca's aphasia patients. Often, we'll see them switching around the sounds and the word they want to say for something similar. So, ask a carpenter what he does for a living, and he might reply with partender. But he wouldn't sub in something like zookeeper. It's switching out phonemes one for another, not swapping entire words. Because the thing is, it's not the case when someone has Broca's aphasia that they lose all of their language skills. It's not global, they still know a lot about language. For one thing, their comprehension is still quite good, if not perfect. This means that they're well aware of the mistakes that they're making, and they often get really frustrated by the fact that they can't say what they really want. They also have trouble with functional morphology, so not the key contentful words in the sentence, but the bits that tell you about number and gender and tense. So for languages like English and Mandarin, where nouns and verbs and other big, meaty meaning bits can stand on their own, functional morphemes just get lost along the way. So in English, you might leave off the ed from a sentence like, I slammed the door, leaving you with just slam. Which is fine, it's just not what you mean. But what if you're in a language where all of the root morphemes need to get attached to something before you can say them? What if you're in a language like Italian, where nouns need to be marked for gender, and then all the adjectives that go along with them have to agree, or you just can't use them right at all? Take the terms for Little Red Riding Hood. Now this should be Cappuccetto Rosso. Little Riding Hood, Cappuccetto, is male, and so normally the adjective for red, Rosso, should be male too. But for a patient with Broca's aphasia, they might pick out the female red, Rosa, instead. It doesn't match, but it's still a possible word. There's no Ros in Italian. You need that suffix, whether it's O or A, and Broca's aphasia patients still know that deep down, they just picked the wrong one. So depending on how your language works, your functional morphology gets impaired in different ways. So communicating with someone who has Broca's aphasia isn't so much a matter of getting your message across as it is getting back theirs. They do have problems understanding some sentences, like passive constructions or certain kinds of questions, but those are limited cases. For the most part, they're fine. Whether it's stammering and switching their phonemes around, or struggling with functional morphology, it's really only their production that's seriously compromised. And it's not like they have problems with non-linguistic stuff either, like, it's not some kind of global cognitive impairment. The kind of mistakes that get made can tell us really specific things about what's going wrong. It tells us a lot about what happens when things go right, too. Looking at what aphasia patients can and can't do, for example, can tell us what Broca's area is responsible for. Since they have trouble getting out the words they want to produce, and they make sound substitution errors, Broca's area must be responsible for speech planning. And since they have problems putting their morphemes together, and with more complicated syntax, those parts of the system should be located there too. But comprehension and word storage are somewhere else, because these are more or less still fine when Broca's area gets damaged. Where exactly? Well, from what we've said before, we know that that should be Wernicke's area, but we'll have to hold off on explaining what happens when that stops working for a future episode, because we've reached the end of the Ling Space for this week. If you weren't stuck in the 1800s, you learned that no two human brains are exactly the same. That Broca's aphasia happens when Broca's area in the brain is damaged by trauma or disease. That Broca's aphasia patients have specific problems with language production, such as with phonemes and functional morphology. And that observing the patterns in their production errors has taught us a lot about what parts of the brain are responsible for language. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Delise Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our production assistants are Georges Coulomb and Stéphane Hurtavies. Our music and sound design is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling Space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Até mais!